iffy about after looking at what all the other attorneys were doing and what I knew we were capable of doing. I knew it was a title that I wanted to shed fast. Not because the word alone bothered me. I just knew that Colony was not doing justice to the caliber of men that we have before us. NC State is more of a chapter kind of school, and I think we all can agree with that. It's not only a testament, today is not only a testament to hard work by all of us, but it's also a mandate to be better in the future, which I know we will be. And I'd like to thank a couple people who are with us today who traveled. Grand High Zeta, David Huffine, thank you so much for being here. Appreciate it, it's an honor. We've just got some headquarters representatives, Justin Fisher, Dave Walthius, Chris Kirkby, and Joe Citro. Thank you for being with us. Dave and Justin have been here from the start with us, and it's been really special to share this day with them. It wasn't too long that Justin Fisher and Dave Walthius were playing flag football with a few undergraduates in the court of Carolina. And not that that wasn't fun, but I think, looking at us now, I think we're glad to be where we're at. If I could travel back in time and tell myself what starting fraternity with my best friends would be like, I think all I could say is just go do it. Just go do it. I can't really describe to anyone what this brotherhood means to me. It's more, the only thing I could say is you have to experience it. I think we all know that. It's an experience. There's nothing that I can say in a few sentences to show what the last 2 years, the last two school years, the last 15 months have meant to me. It's been really, really special. I've been honored to serve as your president for the last year. And finally, I'd like to personally thank High Five Jack White. His unwavering service to this chapter, and I like using that word chapter, has just been, it's been unquestionable, his commitment to all of us. I think Joe can attest that he's at every chapter meeting, he's at every officer meeting, he's at brotherhood events. He does above and beyond what any high pi normally would have to do, and we would not have this day without Jack White. So thank you, Jack. I don't want to take a lot of time, so thank you to everybody for coming today. Let's bow our heads for an invitation of high pi. Graham Bowers wants to come up and do that for us. Thanks.
Hi, it's Bowers. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great day that you bestowed upon us, the brothers of my behalf. We ask that you are here with us today as we receive this charter for the Gamma Upsilon chapter. We ask that you remain with us as we continue to grow and prosper. In your Son's holy name, we pray. Amen.
That's right. So I'd like to give the floor now to someone who's a little bit of a GU celebrity. This is someone who's always inspiring, who's reached his hand out to serve this new colony and another chapter. And I think alumni and undergraduate alone, or together, know that John Kanipe has been a true source of inspiration to all of us. So John, please come up and say a few words, if you don't
mind. First, I'd like to call your attention to the agenda and make a declaration, and that is it will not take you 30 minutes to introduce David Huffine. Second, imagine. Here, because the Lambda guy experience is important.
friends, all the brothers, alumni. This is a great weekend for Lambda Chi Alpha. This comes on the last day of a really historic weekend, because this very weekend we have had four colonies become chapters. Last night I had the chance to be at our then colony at Methodist University, and they became a chapter. And the night before, I wasn't there, but the UNCW colony became a chapter. And also last night, up north with the University of Wisconsin at Whitewater, earned their charter. And so this is a weekend, four new chapters in one weekend, and that's got to be a historic moment. And I know it's definitely history-making for three of them to be in North Carolina. But the only thing that is preventing that completion is the fact that now I have to speak. Because the last charter has not quite yet been given out. But it's a privilege to be here and have a chance to do that. This is a word of this is a sort of personal privilege. Some of the alums came around with their catch-up book and have got some signatures. I've carried around, since I got on the Grand High Zeta, my pedagogus, and I'm collecting signatures everywhere I go for anybody that would care to give me their signature and that, so that can kind of go around. And so without further ado, I really, John, just want to thank you for that introduction. John and I have a very special and deep and long friendship and brotherhood, and really, really more than brotherhood. Or if it can be more than brotherhood, it's certainly the pinnacle of brotherhood that I've had the chance to experience with you. As he alluded, we really got to know each other 30 years ago when he came to deliver the Phi Theta newly minted charter. And as a member of the Grand High Zeta, and me just a lowly High Alpha, we struck up this brotherhood, and it has lasted for a lifetime. Well, it not yet has lasted for a lifetime, but it's lasted all these years. And as John alluded, after I traveled as an ELC for 2 years and tried to then come back to North Carolina and figure out what I was going to do with the rest of the years, he hired me to come down to NC State and work in the development office. And really, it was my first real career job. And 27 years later, I'm still at it. But he was so much more than my boss. He was, and brother, he was really my mentor. He taught me all the fundamentals of our field of fundraising, and while he was doing it, he taught me the fundamentals of life. And not just taught them to me, but modeled them. He reinforced them, sometimes making personal sacrifices to do so. And not just John, but his beautiful wife Jane in the back. They embraced my bride, Linda, and watched over us through the birth of our two daughters and the loss of my parents and job changes and moves. And I think you can see John is still looking out for me. He nominated me to the Grand High Zeta last summer, and much to my surprise, flew out to Phoenix to be there with me when I was elected. And there gave me the first hug and handshake, and of course, next began to give me advice. Anybody knows John, you know, he's got advice to share. And I know that John has given many of you his mentorship. For those of you who have not, especially the colony members, I assure you that John still has excess capacity for brotherhood and mentorship and a willingness to do so. I came across a book, a
I'm reading a book, and I came across a quote in it recently. It's Ann Patch's State of Wonder, and it's about a scientist who is embarking on a journey into the Amazon to discover plant life that he can bring back and use for medicinal discoveries. And while he's in this snake-infested Amazon, he has time to reflect on how he got there and the people that brought him to that point. And he reflects on his old college professor that first introduced him to the field, and he said this: Dr. Rapp used to say we all had a compass inside of us, and what we needed to do was to find it and follow it. But we were undergraduates, and for the most part, we couldn't find our butts with our hands, so we followed his compass instead. No offense to undergraduates, that's hung at me when I was an undergraduate. Until we knew how to be men by our own standards, we tried to be men like Dr. Rapp. John, thank you for being my Dr. Rapp. If I have ever known what true lifetime brotherhood was, it was because the international headquarters screwed up our original charter and sent John Kanipe to bring us the replacement. I've also got to say, I've got another one of my idols here, Murphy Osborne. Murphy came, we met when he was, when we were a colony, and he came down and he helped not only with chartering, but advice along the way towards chartering. And he has served, of course, not only on Grand High Zeta, but as the Grand High Alpha. And so, you know, like, and he was like the speech-making dynamo of Lambda Chi Alpha. Still is. And like, I'm like up here making a speech in front of Murphy Osborne. I mean, I may as well be going into a 3-point shot competition with Scott Wood as to speak in front of you, Murphy. Thank you for all that you have done for this fraternity and for me. Keep going. Now, I could make this whole speech about John and Murphy, but I'm assigned to go a little further because all of you are waiting for this charter down in front. And as I get started in that, I want to say how much at home I feel tonight, because my connections with Gamma Upsilon are deep and historic and go back really further than my connections with John and Murphy. As like green, inexperienced colony members, we often came down to Raleigh to hang out with the Gamma Upsilon brothers and see what big time fraternity life was like. In fact, one such time was during the final game of the NCAA tournament, which I watched with the brothers in the chapter room on what in those days counted as a big screen TV, I think about like 26 inches. With the likes of Rick Bynum and Don Holloway. And we watched that final winning basket and Jim Valvano run out onto the court looking for somebody to hug desperately. That tape, you know, it's played during every NCAA tournament. But I got to watch it live with the brothers of Gamma Upsilon. And thinking about that evening, I'm going to stop there, move on. that's all I really want to say about that evening back in 1983. But that was then, and this is now. And I just got to say, as an old colony man myself, I know how much work this achievement has required, what you had to do to bring you to this day. Each of you can probably recite the chartering standards and what it took to accomplish each one. You live with them, and you slept with them, and you woke up with them, and you brought them to meetings, and you brought them to class and around campus to other organizations. And you traveled with them to Clemson and Greensboro and Richmond and Ames, Iowa and Phoenix. You've put them in the bank. You've sent them to Indianapolis and Kalamazoo. You've laid them out in front of prospective members. and in front of alumni. You've learned them, and you've talked about them, and you've argued about them, and you built them, and you wrote about them, and one by one, you check them off the list. I know what it took you to do all of that, not just because I was part of doing it 30 years ago, but I'm now going through each and every one again as the high pie of the colony at VCU. To tell you the truth, I feel like those chartering standards are like kind of like tattooed on my brain. You know, any of you know that feeling? Yeah. So when I congratulate you, it comes with a real, real deep understanding and admiration and respect for what you've accomplished. When I read your chartering application, it was just a joyful experience reading every word. And when it came time with Grand High Zeta to make the motion that your application be approved, I was like in position to spring because I wanted to be the one to make that motion. Well, there was others that were springing for you too. So the official record will never tell who did it, but I'll tell you it was me. And that's why I hoped I would get invited to be here tonight. There would be no other place I'd rather be. When I read the packet, I was really happy to see the relationship between Phi Theta and Gamma Upsilon really represented and rekindled in this colonization process. One of the requirements for chartering is that letters of endorsement from three other chapters are included. And so I'm just going to read the final closing from one letter involving Phi Theta. It goes this way, quote, "If I may end this letter on a personal note, I would like to express my view on the colony as being one of anticipation concerning the future of these men and what they have started. Their achievements in the past have gained my respect and confidence, and I feel that this colony will prove to be a valuable asset to Lambda Chi Alpha. Signed, sincerely in Sachs, Richard T. Bynum, Jr., Chi Alpha, Gamma Upsilon Zeta." That's not a letter that was written in your behalf. That was a letter that Rick wrote 30 years ago to recommend Phi Theta becoming a chapter. So I was proud to see in your packet the letter from Phi Theta. I hope that Phi Theta has lived up to Rick's prediction. So 30 years later, Juan Vasquez, High Alpha of Phi Theta, was privileged to write, "This letter is to give my highest esteem and recommendation for the North Carolina State Gamma Upsilon Colony to become a chapter. We have kept in contact with them very heavily as they are one of the closest chapters to us. I've had the privilege of watching them grow as a colony through different events and attitudes the chapter has developed." This is a fraternity that is beyond the walls of one school. And the relationships that you form with other chapters, brothers at other schools, are not just to enable your charter. They're to broaden your view of Lambda Chi, give you opportunities for involvement as a stepping stone to involvement with the national fraternity for your whole life. When I think of the achievement of a Lambda Chi Alpha charter, it reminds me of a realm I'd like to take you into for a few minutes. It might be very familiar to some of you. Some of you will have no idea. For others, you might think you know what I'm talking about, but listen very carefully and see if you're right. The realm I speak of is an ancient one, but it is believed to exist even today. This realm is entered through a door. Which once our newcomers enter, they find an eternally burning lamp surrounded by darkness. Instantly, a fantastic journey begins, along which the newcomers encounter swords and helmets and crowns and a shield emblazoned with a lion rampant. Soon, the younger brother is tempted by a life of power and ease and falls for it. Once he realizes his mistake, it's too late. His big brother attempts to rescue him, but is powerless to do so without calling upon the lion rampant, who only through sacrificial death and rebirth is able to redeem the lost brother and restore hope to the realm. Some of you might be catching on to the realm I'm describing. It might help if I add that into this realm enters a pack of wolves. Also, there are talking beavers, a milk-white stag, creatures like fauns and centaurs and giants and dwarves, Father Christmas and a sleigh pulled by reindeer, a white witch and her ice palace, and an enchanted Turkish delight. Have any of you caught on yet? I'm talking about, that's right, the realm of Narnia, which was created by C.S. Lewis, and most famously depicted in his classic book, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. In the book, the Lion of Narnia is Aslan. He's larger than life. When evil took Narnia over years before, in the form of the rule of the White Witch and never-ending winter, Aslan withdrew from Narnia for many years. But the good inhabitants never gave up hope for his return. There was a prophecy in the land that when four humans entered the realm, Aslan would return and with them fight to regain his kingdom. Four youths, the Pevensies, Peter, Susan, Edmund, and Lucy, stumble into Narnia through the wardrobe door and are received as the fulfillment of a prophecy. Word spreads quickly throughout the realm that, quote, Aslan is on the move again. It is Mr. and Mrs. Beaver who explain the prophecy to the brothers and sisters and tell them about Aslan. I'll read the next verse. Oh yes, tell us about Aslan, said several voices at once, for once again that strange feeling like the first signs of spring, like good news, had come over them. Aslan, said Mr. Eber, why, don't you know? He's the king. He's the lord of the whole wood. But not often here, you understand, never in my time or my father's time, but word has reached us that he has come back. He is in Narnia at this moment. He'll settle the White Queen all right. Is he a man? Asked Lucy. Aslan a man? Said Mr. Beaver sternly. Certainly not. Aslan is a lion, the great lion. Ooh, said Susan. I thought he was a man. Is he quite safe? Safe? Said Mr. Beaver. Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He's the king, I tell you. Readers of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, which has sold tens of millions of copies since its release in 1950, have interpreted that story on many different levels. An exciting tale featuring the adventures of talking animals and heroic children, or a morality play of light's triumph over dark, or a powerful allegory of the Christian story of the abiding power of faith and hope and self-sacrificing love. So why does this chartering event remind me of the realm of Narnia? First, Aslan the lion is the center of the realm, just like the lion rampant is the center of Lambda Chi Alpha's coat of arms. You see on our coat of arms, that in the very center there's a shield for our guests, and it has a lion rampant. A sad state of affairs led to the Lions of Lambda Chi leaving NC State in 1998. Even then, it was prophesied that Lambda Chi would return one day, and in 2011 it was recolonized here. You have fought the good fight to chartering. Tonight we celebrate that the Lions of Lambda Chi are on the move again at NC State. Aslan, I challenge you lions not to be safe, but to be good. Now, when I say don't be safe, let me just make a quick disclaimer. Have a harm reduction task force. Fill out your event planning forms on time. Follow all FIPG rules. And it's good to always have a fire extinguisher on hand. That's not the kind of safe I'm talking about. Don't play it safe. Take risks in building your new, freshly minted chapter to be the best it can be. Be willing to keep running even when you are tired. Don't sip the brotherhood, guzzle the brotherhood. Step outside your comfort zone to build a stronger, richer brotherhood with new members and with one another. Life begins where our comfort zones end. And be good. Remember that the lion rampant of Lambda Chi is holding what? A white rose. And without giving away any like ritualistic secrets, everyone knows that a white rose represents purity, love, remembrance, good things. So Lambda Chi Alpha's lion isn't rampant just for the sake of being rampant. He's rampant for the sake of good. Keep that image constantly before your eyes. And keep our oaths and the creed of Lambda Chi constantly on your lips. Live our core values in your personal and collective lives. Our core values, loyalty and duty and respect, service and stewardship and honor and integrity and personal courage. I like that the one at the bottom, it's not a last but least kind of thing, the personal courage is at the bottom because that's almost like the foundation that all the others rest on. Because our core values are radical. They're countercultural. And none of them can be accomplished without your personal courage. We're in a world that doesn't value our values. Look at government leaders. Look at business leaders. There's lots of people in the world. Look in athletics. Anywhere, any field you want to look, and there's people that are considered very successful that are not living out values. Their success is hollow. The success of the men of Lambda Chi is rich and robust and long-lasting. If we will stick to our values, and use our personal courage to keep them alive. Let me see, do I have any runners here? Any runners in the room? Okay, let me ask you, who recognizes the name Roger Bannister? Somebody tell me, who's Roger Bannister? He's the first man to run a sub 4-minute mile. He ran it on May 6th in 1954. He was knighted by Queen Elizabeth in 1975. But you know what? Not for his record-breaking feat of running that mile. Roger Bannister was naturally interested in the emerging field of sports medicine. He went on to become a medical doctor, really a pioneering neurologist. And he became the founding chairman of Sports England, where he's credited with initiating the first testing for the use of anabolic steroids in sports. On the 50th anniversary of running the sub 4-minute mile, Bannister was asked whether he looked back on that accomplishment as the most important one of his life. Bannister replied that no, he didn't. He rather saw his subsequent 40 years of practicing as a neurologist and some of the new procedures he introduced as being much more significant. A lot of people wouldn't have been quite proud of Bannister's athletic feat, and they would have been content to rest on those laurels the rest of their lives. But Bannister pressed on to an ever active and useful life of contributions that made far greater difference in people's lives. I think every Lambda Chi Alpha colony can take a lesson from Dr. Bannister. Chartering is an amazing feat, and you will receive much glory. It is the end of your time as a colony, but it's just the beginning of your time as a chapter. There's so much opportunity ahead for Gamma Upsilon, building an even greater chapter at NC State, rising to the best fraternity that this school has ever seen. Not stopping there, but adding itself to the league of the best chapters of Lambda Chi anywhere. Oh, the places you will go. You could host conclave. You might send members to the international ritual team. You could win awards like the Grand High Alpha Award. You might produce some ELCs. Even some more Grand High Zeta members. But most assuredly, if you will be making a profound difference in the lives of NC State men in coming generations. Indeed, to men who aren't even born yet. You know what the ritualistic ideals and the core values of Lambda Chi are, and how they have challenged you to be better than you were. What you have already built has brought that to you. But don't you think there are other men on this campus, even right now, or coming next fall, coming in the decades ahead, who need those ideals and those values in their lives? Not what you have built, but what you still have yet to build will bring those to them. So now we come to the supreme secret of Lambda Chi Alpha. Our secret is that in the end, Lambda Chi Alpha is not about building better chapters. It is about building better men. For our chapters, better men for our campuses, for our families, for our communities, for our country, for our Creator. For a world that desperately needs men of character, leadership, and values. Step up the game. Roger Bannister left us with a quote that says it well. He said, "Every morning in Africa, a gazelle wakes up. It knows it must outrun the fastest lion or it will be killed. Every morning in Africa, a lion wakes up. It knows it must outrun the slowest gazelle or it will starve. It doesn't matter if you are a lion or if you are a gazelle. When the sun comes up, you better be running." Brothers and friends, this evening is such a time for celebration and pride and congratulations. If you're like I was 30 years ago, it's going to be a proud moment in your life that you'll never forget. Years from now, you're going to come back and you will be revered as the founders. But tomorrow, you must resume the work you were called to Lambda Chi Alpha to do. Sunday, April 28th, will go down in history for Gamma Upsilon. But the most important day is Monday, April 29th, on which, brothers, better be running. So who are the lions rampant of Lambda Chi? Who are they? Anyone? You. You are the lions rampant. You are the men who will fight for everything that Lambda Chi Alpha stands for and win. And it's because you fought this fight thus far that you just have the start to do that. So I congratulate you on this accomplishment.
let me just be sure everyone understands. Right now, you are still a colony. Okay, sorry, Jay. You're still a colony right this moment. And how, but in a few minutes, you will be a chapter. I'd like for, so this is kind of a moment in time, and I'd like, this is presented on behalf of the Grand High Zeta, and so I would like at this time for the other members, former members of Grand High Zeta, John Kanipe and Murphy Osborne, to join me here at the podium. Come forward. And I'd like Jake LaRoe and Jack White to come forward as well. Why don't you stand? And what I will do now the accomplishment of this charter is a collective effort, no doubt, but it is also the accumulation of a lot of individual efforts. And so I'm going to call the name of each and every charter member and ask you to come forward and stand over to the side. Right now, you're all in a colony. When your name is called, you will walk over into a chapter. And when you're all there, you will receive your charter. Thomas Arlen, Malcolm Bennett, Will Bennett, Drew Benningfield, Chance Benoit, David Bowl, Mitchell Boast, Graham Bowers, Brian Branch, Matthew Briley, Nicholas Broussard, Jake Bush, Dylan Coleman, Adam Craven, Joseph Deans, Alex Ewald, Eric Fisher, Eric Foran, Andrew Frink, Joseph Furstenberg, Robert Gilfillan, Adam Green, Jackson Green, Ivy Griffin, Christopher Hall, John Hamby, Jerry Hardesty, Thomas Harris, Samuel Overfield, William Holland, Evan Jones, Brad Killebrew, Jake LaRoe, Chad Linville, Seth McGroder, Thomas McLean, Zavid Muriki, David Nakuzi, Patrick O'Shea, Nolan Peterson, James Perry, Wesley Purcell, Justin Rose, Robert Salmon, Connor Schmidt, Colin Shaw, Andrew Sheridan, Christopher Strickland, Evan Sugar, Anthony Swain, Josh Tatum, Corey Wade, Matthew Welburn, Matthew Westbrook, William Whitaker, Bo White, and LV White before. Those of you still left out there, let's give them a hand. So now, on behalf of the Grand High Zeta, 180 proud other chapters, 14 other envious colonies, I present to you this charter to congratulate you and signify for years ahead the accomplishment that you've built to this day. Thank you.
Yeah, it's okay. All the good stuff's back here. In fact, you can let it wait.
Well, now he's sons and Jimmy grew together. He did his own swim. He's going to get his degree at a scholarship in college in Charleston. That's a good setup right there.
Turn it over to Beth. I mean, holy.